Thank you. I was going to say that I'm the red herring in this conference, being a historian, but Claude pointed out that herring is not a Mediterranean fish, so I'll be an anchovy. Is that okay? So while nutritional theory, both in the past and present, has purported to promote a holistic approach to health, emphasizing overall lifestyle rather than a specific quantity of food or any specific ingredient over any other, the general tendency, especially when broadcast in popular form, has been to vilify certain foods and extol others. We witness this daily as research on the latest superfood is suddenly translated into a marketing blitz, as manufacturers rush to incorporate ingredients into their new value-added and often very highly processed goods. Whether it's antioxidant pomegranates one week, or gluten-free ancient grains, or dairy products infused with live probiotic lactobacillus cultures, whatever the findings of the original research, and however adamant nutritionists are in focusing on overall dietary reform, the public obsesses over simple, reductionist labeling of good foods and bad foods, right? So seemingly capricious changes in opinion render yesterday's hero today's villain. I mean, think of margarine, for example. You know, my parents' generation, margarine was the perfect food, and now it's a trans fat. It is easy to blame manufacturers and their willful use of specialized studies to promote their products. It's easy to blame the media and popular nutrition writers for rendering complex and qualified scientific statements into news-breaking headlines in order to sell papers or their best-selling books sometimes. It's equally easy to blame the public for seeking very easy and simplistic solutions to what are much larger systemic problems in the food supply and patterns of consumption, and the collusion of government nutrition agencies with various agricultural lobbies and business interests has only further complicated this situation. But it all boils down to the simple fact that when dietary recommendations are steered by the interest of profit, information is going to be simplified and it's going to be twisted to sell. And I think the Mediterranean diet we're talking about here is just as susceptible to these forces as any other program. It became a very simple way to promote some goods, right? To promote olive oil, which was really very successful. It was used to promote red wine, which, judging from the sales, also has been very successful. In fact, in the U.S., wine sales have just out-measured beer sales, which is remarkable. Compounded with the general recommendation to consume less red meat and more fruits and vegetables and exercise more, the public overwhelmingly found this program congenial, even if they rarely adopted it in its entirety, given the constraints of modern life. The larger context of the Mediterranean diet, the social setting, the historical circumstances which formed this lifestyle, were lost as it became a vehicle for promoting certain products. Certain elements were just lost completely. Gathering wild herbs was replaced with mass-produced bags of shelf-stable pre-washed spinach, you know, that you could buy on the spinach salad. Walking everywhere, or laboring, for that matter, was replaced with working out an hour at the gym. And the process of transforming edible whole ingredients into nutritious food was replaced by modern prefabricated convenience foods laden with chemical preservatives and flavor enhancers. And I think, you know, that's something that hasn't been addressed much at this conference, is the cooking as a very important part of being healthy and nutrition, eating well. And of course, the act of eating together as a family, both immediate and extended, this whole issue of commensality was replaced by eating on the run, by grabbing food as we make our way to do other important business. That is, we lost not only the entire economic and social context which allowed the Mediterranean and other sustainable diets to flourish, but we replaced them with bland, homogenous simulacrum marketed in the form of health-promoting consumables, goods. And the solution to this situation is not just to dismantle the trappings of modern society and turn back the clock. That's not what I'm going to argue at all, or simply stop selling nutritional superfoods. I think it is to get a sense of how and why diets in the past worked as overall social phenomena, taking into account broader factors such as exercise and environment, and also those things that are usually neglected in modern dietary recommendations. I think cooking from scratch is probably one of the most important things. Sharing food with others, appreciating food on a completely aesthetic level. You know, when do nutritionists talk about food that tastes good, really good? And I think to even begin this process of reassessment, it's necessary to look back into history. So I'm going to give you some examples out of the past about what people ate, what they thought they should be eating, and how nutritional principles in the past, I think much like today, were mostly ignored. Okay, so notwithstanding the purported health benefits of this Mediterranean diet, when you look at it with modern nutritional science, there's little doubt that combining ample exercise, meals featuring fruits and vegetables and legumes, unrefined grains, minimal consumption of meat. The interesting thing is no one ever chose to eat that way, right? That was a necessity. That was not a dietary program. It's the result of deprivation and sometimes even poverty, right? That was the original context. And I think it's essential to understand that as the diet as a social phenomenon. And not only did those who could afford to live a life of leisure eat a lot of meat, but nutritional theory of the past actively recommended that. That was the way people should eat. The Mediterranean lifestyle should really be termed the Mediterranean laboring class diet or working class diet. When that diet is taken in the broad sense of everything that can be altered or controlled. And in fact, the early physiologists used to call these the six non-naturals. So it was not just food, but the rate of digestion, your sleep, your sexual activity, your environment, the air, all those things were taken into consideration. But for anyone who could afford to do so, they were told, eat, get little exercise, you don't want to work too much, eat a diet heavy in meat and poultry, albeit light-colored poultry, you know, foods were preferred, but don't eat a lot of fruits and vegetables. They're not good for you. They're watery, they're phlegmatic, they're difficult to digest, they're of little nutritional value. Now, I'm not going to say that anyone necessarily followed this advice, but that's what people were told. Eat meat, don't eat your fruits and vegetables. And in fact, this Mediterranean diet was considered more appropriate for laborers. They had much stronger digestive systems, so they could handle these rough and coarse vegetables and beans and scraps of offal and darker meats and things like that. And in fact, dark ruddy wines, which we consider, you know, very high in antioxidant flavonoids, those are for workers. Anyone who you know really wants to watch their health should drink light and much sweeter wines. Small oily fish, the ones that are rich in omega-3 fatty acids, those are for the poor. You know, wealthy people should eat larger species high on the food chain, like tuna and sturgeon and things like that. So strangely, the standard nutritional theory of pre-modern Europe is completely diametrically opposed to the Mediterranean diet. It's exactly the opposite, in fact. Let me give you just a couple of cool examples, because I like, you know, I'm a historian. So there's a guy named Antonio Gazzias, or Gazzo, writing in 1491, says, olera omnia sunt mali chimi, propter multitudinem superfluitatem in eis et pocitatem nutrimenti. All vegetables are bad on account of their many superfluities and little nourishment. And he also says, when you eat bread, make sure it doesn't contain too much bran or whole wheat. Avoid, you know, whole grains, avoid chickpeas and lentils, pears, apples, dried figs. All these things are bad for you. Onions, garlic, avoid them like the plague. Turnips, cabbages. Instead, eat things like white bread. That's ideal. Chicken, sea fish, eggs, kid, and lamb. And interestingly, that whole century, the perfect food, I know this is going to chime in very interestingly with our last session, the perfect food is sugar. That is the most nutritious thing. Quote, sapit nutrit, means whatever tastes good to you is what nourishes you best. That's a standard saying in the period, oddly enough. So despite, you know, medical and theory changes in the course of the centuries following, but still the diet is entirely meat-centered, according to recommendations. Baldassare Pisanelli, whose little Trattato della Natura di Cibi e del Bere of 1586, says that lamb and veal are the best of meats, suited for all ages and complexions. Capon is preferred among fowl, sturgeon among fish, but leeks, onions, garlic, lowly vegetables, and I'll quote here, are the worst foods in all seasons for all ages and all complexions. Therefore, you ought to give them to rustics. He says, things like fava beans, they dull the senses. They disturb the sleep. They're only for peasants. Don't think of eating that stuff. Cabbages are also in that category. And without lingering on the point, what I want to sort of stress is that these writers had a very, very clear sense of what the Mediterranean diet was, long before an American dietitian came up with it. But still, it's not. It's what you don't eat. It's food of the lower classes. Now, on the other hand, let me take another side of the coin. There are many... Italy does have a tradition of dietary writers who are kind of outside of this humoral physiology Galenic tradition. And in general, they promote vegetables. There are some, I won't call them quacks, but let's just say there are nutritionists in the past, food writers, who recommend a sober diet. One of these guys, very interesting, Alvise Cornaro, a Venetian gentleman, wrote a discourse on the sober life, which was very, very popular. And he describes how he was really sick. He got to the age of 35, and he was living a really profligate life, drinking a lot and staying up all night. And his doctor says, you have to have a bleeding, you have to do this and that. And he says, you know, I'm not paying attention to the doctor. I'm going to do what I want. I'm going to taste all the foods that I think may be good or bad for me, and I'm going to figure out, I'm going to be my own physician. I'm going to see what works and what doesn't. And he figured out that he had to reduce his food to a much, much lower level. And he lived until, well, by his account, 95, by some other accounts, to 102. But he reduced his food to an entire day. He would eat only 12 ounces of food and 14 ounces. No, that's Santorio, but I'll get to him in a moment. you're close. But it's, so he ate 12 ounces of food and 14 ounces of wine a day. That's two nice full glasses of wine. But his meals consisted of bread, meat, eggs, milk, and soup. And the wine, of course, being an analog to blood, also very nutritious. So his diet was simple and limited, but it's still basically mainstream humoral physiology, still based on meat. There's no vegetables mentioned at all. He doesn't eat vegetables and fruit. And in fact, he says his favorite, the things that really agree with him, are kid and mutton, poultry, river fish. And he says that he admits not everyone can afford this diet, but at least everyone can enjoy bread. So in his mind, it's being sober, but it's essentially not the standard working class diet. He's eating rather refined foods. And in fact, you probably know there are modern proponents of calorie reduction diets that promote longevity. But he says the one thing he avoids is, very interestingly, is fruits, sweets, pastries. And in fact, before he got sick, he mentions that he had a terrible thirst. So my guess is that he's probably diabetic. And he finally figured out, oh, I can't, you know, eat these things that put a spike in my blood sugar. Very, very interesting. Probably discovered just through trial and error. There's another writer, an Italian Protestant exile in England named Giacomo Castelvetro, who was scandalized. He gets to England and he realizes the English don't eat fruits and vegetables. They don't even know how to make a salad. He describes how to make it, with dress it and toss it with your hands. But he starts sort of waxing rhapsodic when he talks about asparagus and lovely artichokes and how these foods are great for the human body. And he describes how, you know, the asparagus should be rolled in oil, salt and peppered, and lightly grilled. Beautiful thing. He gives great recipes for eggplants. But the thing is, he explains, it's hardly surprising that we Italians eat a profusion of fruits and vegetables, some quite unknown and unappreciated elsewhere. First, though Italy is beautiful, it's not as plentifully endowed as France or this fertile isle with meat, so we make it our business to devise other ways of feeding our excessive population. The other equally powerful reason is the heat, which persists for almost 9 months a year, has the effect of making meat seem quite repellent, especially beef, which in such a temperature, one can hardly bear to look at, let alone eat. And importantly, he's not saying these are a class issue about vegetables or not, but interestingly, he's ignoring what the physicians are saying, right? And I think in general, we can say that if you look at the menus of the 16th century, no one paid attention to what the physicians were saying. They ate meat, they ate vegetables, they ate fruits, they did whatever they like. And my larger point here is that these dietary patterns are not shaped by the recommendations of physicians, at least for the majority of people, but rather by the material realities of everyday existence, by the economy, by the environment, by the physical resources at people's disposal, and it makes no sense to just take little elements or ingredients out of them and say, oh, we'll adopt this part of the Mediterranean diet or that. Let me give you just one more example from history to illustrate this point. There's a very interesting physician named Antonio Cocchi who decided that he would promote a completely different way of thinking about nutrition. In fact, in mechanical terms, he thought food is ground up in the stomach, and therefore meat is really not good for you. It clogs up the passages in your body, and people should eat vegetables. Things that are watery promote insensible perspiration, which goes back to Santorio, in fact. And he said he wrote this book called the Kibo Pitagorico. The Pythagorean just meant vegetarian then. And he says that, we should avoid dry foods entirely. Meat is too dry. Eat watery vegetables. Eat soups. Eat things like that. And he was very popular. In fact, Voltaire tried out his diet for a while. It was translated in French. People loved it. He was attacked, viciously torn apart by his colleagues who say he has no idea what he's talking about. The only way to generate meat is with flesh. You cannot live without vegetables. And he says, but look at the Tuscans. They live in poverty, and yet they're so healthy. And his detractors said, you come to our offices, and we'll show you all the cases of pellagra, and we'll show you, this is 18th century, when people start eating more corn, and they say poverty is not healthy for anyone. No matter what you think, you have this romantic image of people eating vegetables and being healthy. It's just not true. So my comments might seem to suggest that I think nutritional theory and any dietary recommendation is therefore futile, right? If cookbooks are going to ignore them, if people in their daily practice are going to ignore them, if daily life means something other than this nutritional formula, that's not what I'm suggesting, though. I think that there are practical lessons that we can learn from these historical examples. If it is, in fact, the social and material context which ultimately determines dietary habits, I don't think any of us are going to suggest lowering the living standard or returning to poverty, right? That's not going to happen unless our economy keeps going down. Maybe it'll be inevitable. But certainly a barrage of conflicting dietary advice, nutritional programs, government policies, they have not worked. Okay, our obesity rates keep rising. Things are still going wrong. And if our ultimate goal is really to encourage people to eat far more fruits and vegetables and whole grains and get more exercise, I think we have to make these attractive options compared to mass-produced food. I think the easiest and most direct way, partly encourage people to cook every day, and I mean really cook, not throw things in the microwave and grab things on the run. And I think from a purely gastronomic point of view, convenience foods, the things that are scientifically engineered and often flavor-enhanced, really kind of dull people's taste buds. They prevent them from enjoying food such that, you know, after you eat a bag of I don't know whether you know what Doritos are, they're crap. They're complete mass-produced chips. You can't taste anything else. They blow your taste buds out. You're wasted for the next day. I think but more importantly, we tell people you must eat your vegetables, but you go to the supermarket and the tomatoes taste awful, you know, and the asparagus is limp and the eggplants are going bad, and we really need good fruits and vegetables if we want people to eat them, not flat, you know, sort of pethy apples and out-of-season fruits that sit on the grocery shelves and have traveled halfway around the country. People will not eat what experts advise if the ingredients taste bad. That's just a fact. I would also encourage people, strangely enough, to eat out less. I know that sounds odd coming from a gastronome, and I don't just mean, you know, fast food or anything. I mean literally, you know, just this habit of grabbing things but also eating out all the time. And I find it very ironic, and I'm not sure this is true of Europe, but in the U.S., the more people read about cooking, the more they watch it on TV, the more they have it in their faces from the media, the less they actually do it. So it's kind of like sex and sports. You know, it falls in that same category as people kind of, feel inadequate when they see a master chef doing it. So they're like, oh, I can't do that. I'll just eat this convenience food. But this objection is probably going to arise, well, who really has time to cook, right? We have long working hours, hectic schedules, people commute all over the place, children with various activities, and I think it's that context that needs to be changed. Time must be set aside systemically by employers, People must be given incentives to live near their workplaces. Activities should not be scheduled when people should be eating. I mean, it's very clear in the French example Claude gave that everyone is doing it at the same time. It's built into the pattern of daily life. That's not the case in the US at all. And cooking on a daily basis simply does not have, given the obstacles, given the plethora of convenience foods and easy ways out. And of course, I think people have been generally de-skilled. In other words, they've lost some of those basic techniques that people had in the past. And I think the simplest solution would be, of course, prevent people from making junk food, fast food, convenience foods. Many people say taxes are the way. I think it's much simpler. You just stop promoting the manufacture of corn, soy, wheat, and things that are transformed into other junk foods and convenience foods, and start subsidizing the growth of vegetables and fruits. Simple enough. If the price differential changes, if meat, you know, if you're choosing, let's say an eggplant costs $3.99 in the US, or a pound of chopped meat costs $1.99, it really should be the other way around, right? And I think if the government is really that serious about promoting health, they will stop pandering to the lobbies, the beef lobbies and the soy and the corn lobbies, and start. And Michelle Obama should actually walk the walk also, not just talk it. You know, it's very nice to tell children, eat healthy and exercise. But, you know, I think unless you change the whole social milieu, that just will not happen. And I'm right on time. Sorry.
Absolutely.